Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Grass Harp by Truman Capote, narrated by Cody Roberts. 1. When was it the first I heard of the grass harp? Long before the autumn we lived in the China tree. An earlier autumn then, and of course it was Dolly who told me. No one else would have known to call it that. A grass harp. If on leaving town you take the church road, you soon will pass a glaring hill of bone-white slabs and brown burnt flowers. This is the Baptist cemetery. Our people, Talbots, Fenwicks, are buried there. My mother lies next to my father, and the graves of kinfolk, 20 or more, are around them like the prone roots of a stony tree. Below the hill grows a field of high Indian grass that changes color with the seasons. Go to see it in the fall, late September, when it has gone red as sunset, when scarlet shadows like firelight breeze over it, and the autumn winds strum on its dry leaves, sighing human music. A harp of voices. Beyond the field begins the darkness of river woods. It must have been on one of those September days when we were there in the woods gathering roots that Dolly said, "Do you hear? That is the grass harp, always telling a story. It knows the stories of all the people on the hill, of all the people who ever lived. And when we are dead, it will tell ours too." After my mother died, my father, a traveling man, sent me to live with his cousins, Verena and Dolly Talbot, two unmarried ladies who were sisters. Before that, I'd not ever been allowed into their house, for reasons no one ever got quite clear. Verena and my father did not speak. Probably Papa asked Verena to lend him some money, and she refused. Or perhaps she did make the loan, and he never returned it. You can be sure that the trouble was over money, because nothing else would have mattered to them so much, especially Verena, who was the richest person in town. The drug store, the dry goods store, a filling station, a grocery, an office building. All this was hers, and the earning of it had not made her an easy woman. Anyway, Papa said he would never set foot inside a house. He told such terrible things about the Talbot ladies. One of the stories he spread, that Verena was a morphodite, has never stopped going around, and the ridicule he heaped on Miss Dolly Talbot was too much even for my mother. She told him he ought to be ashamed, mocking anyone so gentle and harmless. I think they were very much in love, my mother and father. She used to cry every time he went away to sell his frigid airs. He married her when she was 16. She did not live to be 30. The afternoon she died, Papa, calling her name, tore off all his clothes and ran out naked into the yard. It was the day after the funeral that Verena came to the house. I remember the terror of watching her move up the walk. A whip-thin, handsome woman with shingled pepper-salt hair, black, rather virile eyebrows, and a dainty cheek mole. She opened the front door and walked right into the house. Since the funeral, Papa had been breaking things, not with fury, but quietly, thoroughly. He would amble into the parlor, pick up a china figure, muse over it a moment, then throw it against the wall. The floor and stairs were littered with cracked glass, scattered silverware. A ribbed nightgown, one of my mother's, hung over the banister. Verena's eyes flicked over the debris. "Eugene, I want a word with you," she said in that hearty, coldly exalted voice, and Papa answered, "Yes, sit down, Verena. I thought you would come." That afternoon, Dolly's friend, Catherine Creek, came over and packed my clothes, and Papa drove me to the impressive, shadowy house on Talbot Lane. As I was getting out of the car, he tried to hug me, but I was scared of him and wriggled out of his arms. I'm sorry now that we did not hug each other, because a few days later, on his way up to Mobile, his car skidded and fell 50 feet into the gulf. When I saw him again, there were silver dollars weighting down his eyes. Except to remark that I was small for my age, a runt, no one had ever paid any attention to me, But now people pointed me out and said, wasn't it sad, that poor little Colin Fenwick? I tried to look pitiful because I knew it pleased people. Every man in town must have treated me to a Dixie cup or a box of Cracker Jack. And at school I got good grades for the first time. So it was a long while before I calmed down enough to notice Dolly Talbot. And when I did, I fell in love. Imagine what it must have been for her when first I came to the house, a loud and prying boy of 11. She skidded at the sound of my footsteps, or, if there was no avoiding me, folded like the petals of shy lady fern. She was one of those people who can disguise themselves as an object in the room, a shadow in the corner, whose presence is a delicate happening. She wore the quietest shoes, plain virginal dresses with hems that touched her ankles. Though older than a sister, she seemed someone who, like myself, Verena had adopted. Pulled and guided by the gravity of Verena's planet, we rotated separately in the outer spaces of the house. In the attic, a slipshod museum spookily peopled with old display dummies from Verena's dry goods store, there were many loose boards, and by inching these, I could look down into almost any room. Dollar's room, unlike the rest of the house, which bulged with fat, dour furniture, contained only a bed, a bureau, a chair. A nun might have lived there, except for one fact. The walls. Everything was painted an outlandish pink. Even the floor was this color. Whenever I spied on Dolly, she usually was to be seen doing one of two things. She was standing in front of a mirror, snipping with a pair of garden shears her yellow and white, already brief hair. Either that, or she was writing in pencil on a pad of coarse cress paper. She kept wetting the pencil on the tip of her tongue, and sometimes she spoke aloud a sentence as she put it down. "Do not touch sweet foods like candy and salt will kill you for certain." Now I'll tell you, she was writing letters. But at first this correspondence was a puzzle to me. After all, her only friend was Catherine Creek. She saw no one else, and she never left the house, except once a week when she and Catherine went to Riverwoods, where they gathered the ingredients of a dropsy remedy Dolly brewed and bottled. Later I discovered she had customers for this medicine throughout the state, and it was to them that her many letters were addressed. Verena's room, connecting with Dolly's by a passage, was rigged up like an office. There was a roll-top desk, a library of ledgers, filing cabinets. After supper, wearing a green eye shade, she would sit at a desk totaling figures and turning the pages of her ledgers, until even the street lamps had gone out. Though on diplomatic, political terms with many people, Verena had no close friends at all. Men were afraid of her, and she herself seemed to be afraid of women. Some years before, she had been greatly attached to a blonde, jolly girl called Maudie Laura Murphy, who worked for a bit in the post office here, and who finally married a liquor salesman from St. Louis. Verena had been very bitter over this, and said publicly that the man was no account. It was therefore a surprise when, as a wedding present, she gave the couple a honeymoon trip to the Grand Canyon. Maudie and her husband never came back. They opened a filling station nearby Grand Canyon, and from time to time sent Verena Kodak snapshots of themselves. These pictures were a pleasure and a grief. There were nights when she never opened her ledgers, but sat with her forehead leaning in her hands, and the pictures spread on the desk. After she had put them away, she would pace around the room with the lights turned off, and presently there would come a hurt, rusty crying sound, as though she'd tripped and fallen in the dark. That part of the attic, from which I could have looked down into the kitchen, was fortified against me, for it was stacked with trunks like bales of cotton. At that time it was the kitchen I most wanted to spy upon. This was the real living room of the house, and Dolly spent most of the day there chatting with her friend Catherine Creek. As a child, an orphan, Catherine Creek had been hired out to Mr. Uriah Talbot, and they had all grown up together, she and the Talbot sisters, there on the old farm that had since become a railroad depot. Dolly she called Dolly Hart, but Verena she called That One. She lived in the backyard in a tin-roofed, silvery little house set among sunflowers and trellises of butterbean vine. She claimed to be an Indian, which made most people wink, for she was dark as the angels of Africa. But for all I know, it may have been true. Certainly, she dressed like an Indian. That is, she had a string of turquoise beads, and wore enough rouge to put out your eyes. It shone on her cheeks like votive taillights. Most of her teeth were gone. She kept her jaws jacked up with cotton wadding. And Verena would say, "Damn it, Catherine, since you can't make a sensible sound, why in creation won't you go down to Doc Crocker and let him put some teeth in your head?" It was true that she was hard to understand. Dolly was the only one who could fluently translate her friend's muffled, mumbling noises. It was enough for Catherine that Dolly understood her. They were always together, and everything they had to say they said to each other. Bending my ear to an attic beam, I could hear the tantalizing tremor of their voices flowing like sap syrup through the old wood. To reach the attic, you climbed a ladder in the linen closet, the ceiling of which was a trap door. One day, as I started up, I saw that the trap door was swung open, and, listening, heard above me an idle, sweet humming, like the pretty sound small girls make when they are playing alone. I would have turned back, but the humming stopped, and a voice called, "Catherine?" "Colin," I answered, showing myself. The snowflake of Dolly's face held its shape. For once she did not dissolve. "This is where you come? We wondered," she said, her voice frail and crinkling as tissue paper. She had the eyes of a gifted person, kindled, transparent eyes, luminously green as mint jelly. Gazing at me through the attic twilight, they admitted, timidly, that I meant her no harm. "You play games up here, in the attic? I told Verena you would be lonesome." Stooping, she rooted around in the depths of a barrel. "Here now," she said. "You can help me by looking in that other barrel. I'm hunting for a coral castle and a sack of pearl pebbles, all colors. I think Catherine will like that. A bowl of goldfish, don't you? For her birthday, we used to have a bowl of tropical fish. Devils they were, ate each other up. But I remember when we bought them, we went all the way to Bruton, 60 miles. I never went 60 miles before, and I don't know that I ever will again. Ah, see, here it is, the castle." Soon afterwards I found the pebbles. They were like kernels of corn or candy, and, "Have a piece of candy," I said, offering the sack. "Oh, thank you," she said. "I love a piece of candy, even when it tastes like a pebble." We were friends, Dolly and Catherine and me. I was 11, then I was 16. Though no honors came my way, those were the lovely years. I never brought anyone home with me, and I never wanted to. Once I took a girl to the picture show, and on the way home she asked couldn't she come in for a drink of water. If I'd thought she was really thirsty, I would have said all right. But I knew she was faking, just so she could see inside the house the way people were always wanting to. And so I told her she better wait until she got home. She said, "All the world knows Dolly Talbot's gone, and you're gone too." I liked that girl well enough, but I gave her a shove anyway. And she said her brother would fix my wagon, which he did. Right here at the corner of my mouth, I've still got a scar where he hit me with a Coca-Cola bottle. I know. Dolly, they said, was Verena's cross, and said, too, that more went on in the house on Talbot Lane than a body cared to think about. Maybe so. But those were the lovely years. On winter afternoons, as soon as I came in from school, Catherine hustled open a jar of preserves, while Dolly put a foot-high pot of coffee on the stove and pushed a pan of biscuits into the oven. And the oven, opening, would let out a hot vanilla fragrance. For Dolly, who lived off sweet foods, was always baking a pound cake, raisin bread, some kind of cookie or fudge. Never would touch a vegetable, and the only meat she liked was the chicken brain, a pea-sized thing gone before you've tasted it. Well, with a wood stove and an open fireplace, the kitchen was warm as a cow's tongue. The nearest winter came was to frost the windows with its zero blue breath. If some wizard would like to make me a present, let him give me a bottle filled with the voices of that kitchen, the ha-ha-ha and fire-whispering, a bottle brimming with its buttery, sugary bakery smells. Though Catherine smelled like a sow in the spring, it looked more like a cozy parlor than a kitchen. There was a hook rug on the floor, rocking chairs. Ranged along the walls were pictures of kittens, an enthusiasm of dollies. There was a geranium plant that bloomed, then bloomed again all year round, and Catherine's goldfish, in a bowl on the oilcloth-covered table, fanned their tails through the portals of the coral castle. Sometimes we worked jigsaw puzzles, dividing the pieces among us, and Catherine would hide pieces if she thought you were going to finish your part of the puzzle before she finished hers, or they would help with my homework. That was a mess. About all natural things, Dolly was sophisticated. She had the subterranean intelligence of a bee that knows where to find the sweetest flower. She could tell you of a storm a day in advance, predict the fruit of the fig tree, lead you to mushrooms and wild honey, a hidden nest of guinea hen eggs. She looked around her and felt what she saw. But about homework, Dolly was as ignorant as Catherine. America must have been called America before Columbus came. It stands to reason. Otherwise, how would he have known it was America? And Catherine said, "That's correct. America's an old Indian word." Of the two, Catherine was the worst. She insisted on her infallibility, and if you did not write down exactly what she said, she got jumpy and spilled the coffee or something. But I never listened to her again after what she said about Lincoln, that he was part Negro and part Indian and only a speck white. Even I knew this was not true. But I am under special obligation to Catherine. If it had not been for her, who knows whether I would have grown to ordinary human size. At 14, I was not much bigger than Biddy Skinner, and people told how he'd had offers from a circus. Catherine said, "Don't worry yourself, honey. All you need is a little stretching." She pulled at my arms, legs, tugged at my head as though it were an apple latched to an unyielding bough. But it's the truth that within 2 years, she'd stretched me from 4'9" to 5'7". And I can prove it by the bread knife notches on the pantry door. For even now, when so much is gone, when there is only wind in the stove and winter in the kitchen, those growing-up scars are still there, a testimony. Despite the generally beneficial effect Dolly's medicine appeared to have on those who sent for it, letters once in a while came saying, "Dear Miss Talbot, we won't be needing any more dropsy cure on account of poor Cousin Belle, or whoever. Passed away last week, bless her soul." Then the kitchen was a mournful place. With folded hands and nodding heads, my two friends bleakly recalled the circumstances of the case. "And well," Catherine would say, "we did the best we could, Dolly Hart, but the good Lord had other notions." Verena, too, could make the kitchen sad, as she was always introducing a new rule or enforcing an old one. Do, don't, stop, start. It was as though we were clocks she kept an eye on, to see that our time jibed with her own, and woe if we were 10 minutes fast, an hour slow. Verena went off like a cuckoo. "That one?" said Catherine, and Dolly would go, "Hush now, hush now," as though to quiet not Catherine, but a mutinous inner whispering. Verena in her heart wanted, I think, to come into the kitchen and be a part of it, but she was too like a lone man in a house full of women and children, and the only way she could make contact with us was through assertive outbursts. "Dolly, get rid of that kitten. You want to aggravate my asthma? Who left the water running in the bathroom? Which one of you broke my umbrella?" Her ugly mood sifted through the house like a sour yellow mist. "That one. Hush now, hush." Once a week, Saturdays mostly, we went to River Woods. For these trips, which lasted the whole day, Catherine fried a chicken and deviled a dozen eggs, and Dolly took along a chocolate layer cake and a supply of divinity fudge. Thus armed, and carrying 3 empty grain sacks, we walked out the church road past the cemetery and through the field of Indian grass. Just entering the woods there was a double-trunk china tree. Really 2 trees, but their branches were so embraced that you could step from one into the other. In fact, they were bridged by a treehouse. Spacious, sturdy, a model of a treehouse. It was like a raft floating in the sea of leaves. The boys who built it, provided they are still alive, must by now be very old men. Certainly the treehouse was 15 or 20 years old when Dolly first found it, and that was a quarter of a century before she showed it to me. To reach it was easy as climbing stairs. There were footholds of gnarled bark and tough vines to grip. Even Catherine, who was heavy around the hips and complained of rheumatism, had no trouble. But Catherine felt no love for the treehouse. She did not know, as Dolly knew and made me know, that it was a ship, that to sit up there was to sail along the cloudy coastline of every dream. "Mark my word," said Catherine. "Them boards are too old. Them nails are slippery as worms. Gonna crack in two. Gonna fall and bust our heads, don't I know it." Storing our provisions in the treehouse, we separated into the woods, each carrying a grain sack to be filled with herbs, leaves, strange roots. No one, not even Catherine, knew altogether what went into the medicine, for it was a secret Dolly kept to herself, and we were never allowed to look at the gatherings in her own sack. She held tight to it, as though inside she had captive a blue-haired child, a bewitched prince. This was her story.
"Once, back yonder, when we were children, Verena still with her baby teeth and Catherine no higher than a fence post, there were gypsies thick as birds in a blackberry patch. Not like now, when maybe you see a few straggling through each year. They came with spring, sudden, like dogwood pink. They were there, up and down the road and in the woods around. But our men hated the sight of them, and Daddy, that was your great-uncle Uriah, said he would shoot any he caught on our place. And so I never told when I saw the gypsies taking water from the creek or stealing old winter pecans off the ground. Then one evening, it was April and fallen rain, I went out to the cowshed where Fairy Bell had a new little calf. And there in the cowshed were 3 gypsy women, 2 of them old and 1 of them young. And the young one was lying naked and twisting on the corn shucks. When they saw that I was not afraid, that I was not going to run and tell, one of the old women asked would I bring a light. So I went to the house for a candle, and when I came back, the woman who had sent me was holding a red hollering baby upside down by its feet, and the other women was milking Fairy Bell. I helped them wash the baby in the warm milk and wrap it in a scarf. Then one of the old women took my hand and said, "Now I'm going to give you a gift by teaching you a rhyme." It was a rhyme about evergreen bark, dragonfly fern, and all the other things we come here in the woods to find. "Boil till dark and pure if you want a dropsy cure." In the morning they were gone. I looked for them in the fields and on the road. There was nothing left of them but the rhyme in my head. Calling to each other, hooting like owls loose in the daytime, we worked all morning in opposite parts of the woods. Towards afternoon, our sacks fat with skinned bark, tender, torn roots, we climbed back into the green web of the china tree and spread the food. There was good creek water in a mason jar, or if the weather was cold, a thermos of hot coffee. And we wadded leaves to wipe our chicken-stained, fudge-sticky fingers. Afterwards, telling fortunes with flowers, speaking of sleepy things, it was as though we floated through the afternoon on the raft and the tree. We belonged there, as the sun's silvered leaves belonged, the dwelling whippoorwills. About once a year, I go over to the house on Talbot Lane and walk around in the yard. I was there the other day, and came across an old iron tub lying overturned in the weeds like a black fallen meteor. Dolly. Dolly hovering over the tub, dropping our grain sack gatherings into boiling water and stirring. Stirring with a sawed-off broomstick, the brownest tobacco spit brew. She did the mixing of the medicine alone, while Catherine and I stood watching like apprentices to a witch. We all helped later with the bottling of it, and, because it produced a fume that exploded ordinary corks, my particular job was to roll stoppers of toilet paper. Sales averaged around 6 bottles a week, at $2 a bottle. The money, Dolly said, belonged to the 3 of us, and we spent it fast as it came in. We were always sending away for stuff advertising magazines. Take up wood carving, Parcheesi, the game for young and old. Anyone can play a bazooka. Once we sent away for a book of French lessons. It was my idea that if we got to talk French, we would have a secret language that Verena or nobody would understand. Dolly was willing to try, but passez-moi a spoon was the best she ever did. And after learning je suis fatigue, Catherine never opened the book again. She said that was all she needed to know. Verena often remarked that there would be trouble if anyone ever got poisoned, but otherwise she did not show much interest in the dropsy cure. Then one year, we totaled up and found we'd earned enough to have to pay an income tax. Whereupon Verena began asking questions. Money was like a wildcat whose trail she stalked with a trained hunter's muffled step, and an eye for every broken twig. What, she wanted to know, went into the medicine. And Dolly, flattered, almost giggling, nonetheless waved her hands and said, well, this and that. Nothing special. Verena seemed to let the matter die, yet very often, sitting at the supper table, her eyes paused ponderingly on Dolly. And once, when we were gathered in the yard around the boiling tub, I looked up and saw Verena in a window watching us with uninterrupted fixity. By then, I suppose, her plan had taken shape, but she did not make her first move until summer. Twice a year, in January and again in August, Verena went on buying trips to St. Louis or Chicago. That summer, the summer I reached 16, she went to Chicago and after 2 weeks returned accompanied by a man called Dr. Morris Ritz. Naturally, everyone wondered who was Dr. Morris Ritz. He wore bow ties and sharp jazzy suits. His lips were blue, and he had gaudy, small, swerving eyes. Altogether, he looked like a mean mouse. We heard that he lived in the best room at the Lola Hotel and ate steak dinners at Phil's Cafe. On the streets, he strutted along bobbing his shiny head at every passerby. He made no friends, however, and was not seen in the company of anyone except Verena, who never brought him to the house and never mentioned his name, until one day, Catherine had the gall to say, Miss Verena? Just who is this funny-looking little Dr. Morris Ritz? And Verena, getting white around the mouth, replied, Well, now, he's not half so funny-looking as some I could name. Scandalous, people said, the way Verena was carrying on with that little Jew from Chicago, and him 20 years younger. The story that got around was that they were up to something out in the old cannon factory the other side of town. As it developed, they were. But not what the gang at the pool hall thought. Most any afternoon you could see Verena and Dr. Morris Ritz walking out toward the cannon factory, an abandoned, blasted brick ruin with jagged windows and sagging doors. For a generation, no one had been near it except school kids who went there to smoke cigarettes and get naked together. Then early in September, by way of a notice in the Courier, we learned for the first time that Verena had bought the old cannon factory. But there was no mention as to what use she was planning to make of it. Shortly after this, Verena told Catherine to kill 2 chickens as Dr. Morris Ritz was coming to Sunday dinner. During the years that I lived there, Dr. Morris Ritz was the only person ever invited to dine at the house on Talbot Lane. So for many reasons, it was an occasion. Catherine and Dolly did a spring cleaning. They beat rugs, brought china from the attic, had every room smelling of floor wax and lemon polish. There was to be fried chicken and ham, English peas, sweet potatoes, rolls, banana pudding, 2 kinds of cake and tutti frutti ice cream from the drugstore. Sunday noon, Verena came in to look at the table, with its sprawling centerpiece of peach-colored roses and dense, fancy stretches of silverware. It seemed set for a party of 20. Actually, there were only 2 places. Verena went ahead and set 2 more, and Dolly, seeing this, said weakly, well, it was all right if Colin wanted to eat at the table, but that she was going to stay in the kitchen with Catherine. Verena put her foot down. Don't fool with me, Dolly. This is important. Morris is coming here expressly to meet you. And what is more, I'd appreciate it if you'd hold up your head. It makes me dizzy hanging like that. Dolly was scared to death. She hid in her room, and long after our guest had arrived, I had to be sent to fetch her. She was lying in the pink bed with a wet wash rag on her forehead, and Catherine was sitting beside her. Catherine is all sleeked up, rouge on her cheeks like lollipops, and her jaws jammed with more cotton than ever. She said, "Honey, you ought to get up from there. You're going to ruin that pretty dress." It was a calico dress Verena had brought from Chicago. Dolly sat up and smoothed it, then immediately lay down again. "If Verena knew how sorry I am," she said helplessly, and so I went and told Verena that Dolly was sick. Verena said she'd see about that, and marched off, leaving me alone in the hall with Dr. Morris Ritz. Oh, he was a hateful thing. "So you're 16, he said, winking first one, then the other of his sassy eyes. "And throwing it around, huh? Make the old lady take you next time she goes to Chicago. Plenty of good stuff there to throw it at." He snapped his fingers and jiggled his razzle-dazzle, dagger-sharp shoes as though keeping time to some vaudeville tune. He might have been a tap dancer, or a soda jerk, except that he was carrying a briefcase, which suggested a more serious occupation. I wondered what kind of doctor he was supposed to be. Indeed, was on the point of asking, when Verena returned, steering Dolly by the elbow. The shadows of the hall, the tapestried furniture failed to absorb her. Without raising her eyes, she lifted a hand, and Dr. Ritz gripped it so ruggedly, pumped it so hard, she went nearly off balance. "Gee, Miss Talbot, am I honored to meet you," he said, and cranked his bow tie. We sat down to dinner, and Catherine came around with the chicken. She served Verena, then Dolly, and when the doctor's turn came, he said, "Tell you the truth, the only piece of chicken I care about is the brain. Don't suppose you'd have that back in the kitchen, Mammy?" Catherine looked so far down her nose, she got almost cross-eyed, and with her tongue all mixed up in the cotton wadding, she told him that Dolly's took those brains on her plate. "These southern accents. Jesus," he said, genuinely dismayed.
"She says I have the brains on my plate," said Dolly, her cheeks red as Catherine's rouge. "But please, let me pass him to you.
If you're sure you don't mind."
"She doesn't mind a bit," said Verena. "She only eats sweet things anyway. Here, Dolly, have some banana pudding."
Presently, Dr. Ritz commenced a fit of sneezing.
"The flowers, those roses, old allergy."
"Oh, dear," said Dolly, who, seeing an opportunity to escape into the kitchen, seized the bowl of roses. It slipped. Crystal crashed. Roses landed in gravy, and gravy landed on us all.
"You see," she said, speaking to herself and with tears teetering in her eyes. "You see, it's hopeless."
"Nothing is hopeless, Dolly. Sit down and finish your pudding," Verena advised in a substantial, chin-up voice.
"Besides, we have a nice little surprise for you. Morris, show Dolly those lovely labels."
Murmuring, "No harm done," Dr. Ritz stopped rubbing gravy splotches off his sleeve and went into the hall, returning with his briefcase. His fingers buzzed through a sheaf of papers, then lighted on a large envelope which he passed down to Dolly. There were gum stickers in the envelope, triangular labels with orange lettering,
Gypsy Queen Dropsy Cure, and a fuzzy picture of a woman wearing a bandana and gold ear loops.
First class, huh? Said Dr. Ritz. Made in Chicago. A friend of mine drew the picture. Real artist, that guy.
Dolly shuffled the labels with a puzzled, apprehensive expression, until Verena asked,
Aren't you pleased?
The labels twitched in Dolly's hands.
I'm not sure I understand.
Of course you do, said Verena, smiling thinly. It's obvious enough. I told Morris that old story of yours, and he thought of this wonderful name.
Gypsy Queen Dropsy Cure. Very catchy, that, said the doctor. Look great in ads.
My medicine?
Said Dolly, her eyes still lowered.
But I don't need labels, Verena. I write my own.
Dr. Ritz snapped his fingers. Say, that's good. We can have labels printed like her own handwriting. Personal, see?
We've spent enough money already, Verena told him briskly, and, turning to Dolly, said, Morris and I are going up to Washington this week to get a copyright on these labels and register a patent for the medicine. Naming you as the inventor, naturally. Now the point is, Dolly, you must sit down and write out a complete formula for us.
Dolly's face loosened, and the labels scattered on the floor, skimmed. Leaning her hands on the table, she pushed herself upward. Slowly her features came together again. She lifted her head and looked blinkingly at Dr. Ritz, at Verena.
It won't do, she said quietly.
She moved to the door, put a hand on its handle.
It won't do, because you haven't any right, Verena. Nor you, sir.
I helped Catherine clear the table. The ruined roses, the uncut cakes, the vegetables no one had touched. Verena and her guests had left the house together. From the kitchen window, we watched them as they went toward town nodding and shaking their heads. Then we sliced the devil's food cake and took it into Dolly's room.
Hush now. Hush now,
she said when Catherine began lighting into that one. But it was as though the rebellious inner whispering had become a raucous voice, an opponent she must outshout.
Hush now. Hush now,
until Catherine had to put her arms around Dolly and say hush too. We got out a deck of rook cards and spread them on the bed. Naturally, Catherine had to go and remember it was Sunday. She said maybe we could risk another black mark in the judgment book, but there were too many beside her name already. After thinking it over, we told fortunes instead. Sometime around dusk, Verena came home. We heard her footsteps in the hall. She opened the door without knocking, and Dolly, who was in the middle of my fortune, tightened her hold on my hand. Verena said,
Cullen, Catherine, we will excuse you.
Catherine wanted to follow me up the ladder into the attic, except she had on her fine clothes, so I went alone. There was a good knot hole that looked straight down into the pink room, but Verena was standing directly under it, and all I could see was her hat, for she was still wearing the hat she'd put on when she left the house. It was a straw skimmer decorated with a cluster of celluloid fruit.
Those are facts, she was saying,
and the fruit shivered, shimmered in the blue dimness.
2,000 for the old factory. Bill Tatum and four carpenters working out there at 80 cents an hour. $7,000 worth of machinery already ordered. Not to mention what a specialist like Morris Ritz is costing. And why? All for you.
All for me? And Dolly sounded sad and failing as the dusk. I saw her shadow as she moved from one part of the room to another.
You are my own flesh, and I love you tenderly. In my heart, I love you. I could prove it now by giving you the only thing that has ever been mine. Then you would have it all. Please, Verena, she said, faltering. Let this one thing belong to me.
Verena switched on a light.
You speak of giving,
and her voice was hard as the sudden bitter glare.
All these years that I've worked like a field hand,
What haven't I given you? This house? That...
You've given me everything, Dolly interrupted softly. And to Catherine, and to Colin. Except, we've earned our way a bit. We've kept a nice home for you, haven't we?
Oh, a fine home, said Verena, whipping off her hat. Her face was full of blood. You and that gurgling fool. Has it not struck you that I never ask anyone into this house? And for a very simple reason. I'm ashamed to. Look what happened today.
I could hear the breath go out of Dolly.
I'm sorry, she said faintly. I truly am. I'd always thought there was a place for us here, that you needed us somehow. But it's going to be all right now, Verena. We'll go away.
Verena sighed. Poor Dolly. Poor, poor thing. Wherever would you go? The answer, a little while in coming, was fragile as the flight of a moth.
I know a place.
Later, I waited in bed for Dolly to come and kiss me goodnight. My room, beyond the parlor in a faraway corner of the house, was the room where their father, Mr. Uriah Talbot, had lived. In his mad old age, Verena had brought him here from the farm, and here he died, not knowing where he was. Though dead 10, 15 years, the pea and tobacco old man smell of him still saturated the mattress, the closet, and on a shelf in the closet was the one possession he'd carried away with him from the farm, a small yellow drum. As a lad my own age, he'd marched in a Dixie regiment rattling this little yellow drum and singing. Dolly said that when she was a girl, she liked to wake up winter mornings and hear her father singing as he went about the house building fires. After he was old, after he died, she sometimes heard his songs in the field of Indian grass. Wind, Catherine said, and Dolly told her.
But the wind is us. It gathers and remembers all our voices, then sends them talking and telling through the leaves and the fields. I've heard Papa clear as day.
On such a night, now that it was September, the autumn winds would be curving through the taut red grass, releasing all the gone voices, and I wondered if he was singing among them, the old man in whose bed I lay fallen asleep. Then I thought Dolly at last had come to kiss me goodnight, for I woke up sensing her near me in the room. But it was almost morning. Beginning light was like a flower and foliage at the windows, and roosters ranted in distant yards.
Shh, Colin,
Dolly whispered, bending over me. She was wearing a woolen winter suit and a hat with a traveling veil that misted her face.
I only wanted you to know where we are going. To the treehouse?
I said, and thought I was talking in my sleep. Dolly nodded.
Just for now, until we know better what our plans will be.
She could see that I was frightened, and put a hand on my forehead.
You and Catherine? But not me?
And I was jerking with a chill.
You can't leave without me.
The town clock was tolling. She seemed to be waiting for it to finish before making up her mind. It struck 5, and by the time the note had died away, I had climbed out of bed and rushed into my clothes. There was nothing for Dolly to say except,
"Don't forget your comb."
Catherine met us in the yard. She was crooked over with the weight of a brimming oilcloth satchel. Her eyes were swollen. She had been crying. And Dolly, oddly calm and certain of what she was doing, said, "It doesn't matter, Catherine. We can send for your goldfish once we find a place." Verena's closed, quiet windows loomed above us. We moved cautiously past them and silently out the gate. A fox terrier barked at us, but there was no one on the street, and no one saw us pass through town except a sleepless prisoner gazing from the jail. We reached the field of Indian grass at the same moment as the sun. Dolly's veil flared in the morning breeze, and a pair of pheasants, nesting in our path, swept before us, their metal wings swapping the coxcomb scarlet grass. The china tree was a September bowl of green and greenish gold. "Gonna fall, gonna bust our heads," Catherine said, as all around us the leaves shook down their dew. 2. If it hadn't been for Riley Henderson, I doubt anyone would have known, or at least known so soon, that we were in the tree. Catherine had loaded her oilcloth satchel with the leftovers from Sunday dinner, and we were enjoying a breakfast of cake and chicken when gunfire slapped through the woods. We sat there with cake going dry in our mouths. Below, a sleek bird dog cantered into view, followed by Riley Henderson, who was shouldering a shotgun, and around his neck there hung a garland of bleeding squirrels, whose tails were tied together. Dolly lowered her veil, as though to camouflage herself among the trees. He paused not far away, and his wary, tanned young face tightened. Propping his gun into position, he took a Roman aim, as if waiting for a target to present itself. The suspense was too much for Catherine, who shouted, "Riley Henderson, don't you dare shoot us!" His gun wavered, and he spun around, the squirrels swinging like a loose necklace. Then he saw us in the tree, and after a moment he said, "Well, hello there, Catherine Creek. Hello, Miss Talbot. What are you folks doing up there? Wildcat chase you?"
"Just sitting," said Dolly promptly, as though she were afraid for either Catherine or I to answer.
"That's a fine mess of squirrels you've got. Take a couple," he said, detaching two. "We had some for supper last night, and they were real tender. But wait a minute, I'll bring them up to you."
You don't have to do that. Just leave them on the ground."
But he said ants would get at them, and hauled himself into the tree. His blue shirt was spotted with squirrel blood, and flecks of blood glittered in his rough leather-colored hair. He smelled of gunpowder, and his homely, well-made face was brown as cinnamon.
"I'll be damned. It's a treehouse," he said, pounding his foot as though to test the strength of the boards.
Catherine warned him that maybe it was a treehouse now, but it wouldn't be for long if he didn't stop that stamping. He said, "You build it, Colin?" And it was with a happy shock that I realized he'd called my name. I hadn't thought Riley Henderson knew me from dust, but I knew him all right. No one in our town ever had themselves so much talked about as Riley Henderson. Older people spoke of him with sighing voices, and those nearer his own age, like myself, were glad to call him mean and hard. That was because he would only let us envy him, would not let us love him, be his friend. Anyone could have told you the facts. He was born in China, where his father, a missionary, had been killed in an uprising. His mother was from this town, and her name was Rose. Though I never saw her myself, people say she was a beautiful woman until she started wearing glasses. She was rich, too, having received a large inheritance from her grandfather. When she came back from China, she brought Riley, then 5, and 2 younger children, both girls. They lived with her unmarried brother, Justice of the Peace Horace Holton, a meaty, spinsterish man with skin yellow as quince. In the following years, Rose Henderson grew strange in her ways. She threatened to sue Verena for selling her a dress that shrank in the wash. To punish Riley, she made him hop on one leg around the yard, reciting the multiplication table. Otherwise, she let him run wild. And when the Presbyterian minister spoke to her about it, she told him she hated her children and wished they were dead. And she must have meant it. For one Christmas morning, she locked the bathroom door and tried to drown her 2 little girls in the tub. It was said that Riley broke the door down with a hatchet, which seems a tall order for a boy of 9 or 10, whatever he was. Afterwards, Rose was sent off to a place on the Gulf Coast, an institution, and she may still be living there. At least I've never heard that she died. Now, Riley and his uncle Horace Holton couldn't get on. One night he stole Horace's Oldsmobile and drove out to the dance and dine with Mammy Curtis. She was fast as lightning, and maybe 5 years older than Riley, who was not more than 15 at the time. Well,
Horace heard they were at the dancing dine and got the sheriff to drive him out there. He said he was going to teach Riley a lesson and have him arrested. But Riley said, "Sheriff, you're after the wrong party." Right there in front of a crowd, he accused his uncle of stealing money that belonged to Rose and that was meant for him and his sisters. He offered to fight it out on the spot, and when Horace held back, he just walked over and socked him in the eye. The sheriff put Riley in jail, but Judge Cool, an old friend of Rose's, began to investigate, and sure enough, it turned out Horace had been draining Rose's money into his own account. So Horace simply packed his things and took the train to New Orleans, where, a few months later, we heard that, billed as the Minister of Romance, he had a job marrying couples on an excursion steamer that made moonlight cruises up the Mississippi. From then on, Riley was his own boss. With money borrowed against the inheritance he was coming into, he bought a red racy car and went skidding round the countryside with every floozy in town. The only nice girls you ever saw in that car were his sisters. He took them for a drive Sunday afternoons, a slow, respectable circling of the square. They were pretty girls, his sisters, but they didn't have much fun, for he kept a strict watch, and boys were afraid to come near them. A reliable colored woman did their housework, otherwise they lived alone. One of his sisters, Elizabeth, was in my class at school, and she got the best grades, straight A's. Riley himself had quit school, but he was not one of the pool hall loafs, nor did he mix with them. He fished in the daytime or went hunting. Around the old Holton house he made many improvements, as he was a good carpenter, and a good mechanic, too. For instance, he built a special car horn. It wailed like a train whistle, and in the evening you could hear it howling as he roared down the road on his way to a dance in another town. How I longed for him to be my friend. And it seemed possible. He was just 2 years older. But I could remember the only time he ever spoke to me. Spruce in a pair of white flannels, he was off to a dance at the clubhouse, and he came into Verena's drugstore, where I sometimes helped out on Saturday nights. What he wanted was a package of shadows, but I wasn't sure what shadows were, so he had to come behind the counter and get them out of the drawer himself. And he laughed, not unkindly, though it was worse than if it had been. Now he knew I was a fool. We would never be friends. Dolly said, "Have a piece of cake, Riley." And he asked did we always have picnics this early in the day, then went on to say he considered it a fine idea. "Like swimming at night," he said. "I come down here while it's still dark and go swimming in the river. Next time you have a picnic, call out so I'll know you're here." "You are welcome any morning," said Dolly, raising her veil. "I dare say we will be here for some while." Riley must have thought it a curious invitation, but he did not say so. He produced a package of cigarettes and passed it around. When Catherine took one, Dolly said, "Catherine Creek, you've never touched tobacco in your life." Catherine allowed as to how she may have been missing something. "It must be a comfort. So many folks speak in his favor, and Dolly Hart, when you get to be our age, you've got to look for comforts." Dolly bit a lip. "Well, I don't suppose there's any harm," she said, and accepted a cigarette herself. There are two things that will drive a boy crazy, according to Mr. Hand, who caught me smoking in the lavatory at school, and I'd given up one of them, cigarettes, 2 years before, not because I thought it would make me crazy, but because I thought it was imperiling my growth. Actually, now that I was a normal size, Riley was no taller than me, though he seemed to be, for he moved with the drawn-out cowboy awkwardness of a lanky man. So I took a cigarette, and Dolly, gushing inhaled smoke, said she thought we might as well be sick together. But no one was sick, and Catherine said next time she would like to try a pipe, as they smelled so good. Whereupon Dolly volunteered the surprising fact that Verena smoked a pipe, something I'd never known. "I don't know whether she does it any more, but she used to have a pipe and a can of Prince Albert with half an apple cut up in it. But you mustn't tell that," she said, suddenly aware of Riley, who laughed aloud. Usually, glimpsed on the street or seen passing in his car, Riley wore a tense, trigger-tempered expression. But there in the china tree, he seemed relaxed. Frequent smiles enriched his whole face, as though he wanted at least to be friendly, if not friends. Dolly, for her part, appeared to be at ease and enjoying his company. Certainly she was not afraid of him. Perhaps it was because we were in the treehouse, and the treehouse was her own.
"Thank you for the squirrels, sir," she said, as he prepared to leave. "And don't forget to come again."
He swung himself to the ground. "Want a ride? My car's up by the cemetery," Dolly told him.
"That's kind of you. But really, we haven't any place to go."
Grinning, he lifted his gun and aimed it at us. And Catherine yelled, "You ought to be whipped, boy!" But he laughed and waved and ran, his bird dog barking, booming ahead. Dolly said gaily,
"Let's have a cigarette."
For the package had been left behind. By the time Riley reached town, the news was roaring in the air like a flight of bees, how we'd run off in the middle of the night. Though neither Catherine nor I knew it, Dolly had left a note, which Verena found when she went for her morning coffee. As I understand it, this note simply said that we were going away, and that Verena would not be bothered by us any more. She at once rang up a friend, Morris Ritz, at the Lola Hotel, and together they traipsed off to rouse the sheriff. It was Verena's backing that had put the sheriff into office. He was a fast-stepping, brassy young fellow with a brutal jaw and the bashful eyes of a card shop. His name was Junius Candle. Can you believe it? The same Junius Candle who is a senator today. A searching party of deputies was gathered. Telegrams were hurried off to sheriffs in other towns. Many years later, when the Talbot estate was being settled, I came across the handwritten original of this telegram, composed, I believe, by Dr. Ritz. "Be on lookout for following persons traveling together. Dolly Augusta Talbot, white, age 60, yellow grayish hair, thin, height 5'3", green eyes, probably insane but not likely to be dangerous. Post description bakeries as she is cake eater. Catherine Creek, Negro, pretends to be Indian, age about 60, toothless, confused speech, short and heavy, strong, likely to be dangerous. Colin Talbot Fenwick, white, age 16, looks younger, height 5'7", blonde, gray eyes, thin, bad posture, scarred corner of mouth, surly natured. All three wanted as runaways.
They sure haven't run far,
Riley said in the post office, and postmistress Mrs. Peters rushed to the telephone to say Riley Henderson had seen us in the woods below the cemetery. While this was happening, we were peaceably setting about to make the treehouse cozy. From Catherine's satchel we took a rose and gold scrap quilt, and there was a deck of rook cards, soap, rolls of toilet paper, oranges and lemons, candles, a frying pan, a bottle of blackberry wine, and two shoe boxes filled with food. Catherine bragged that she'd robbed the pantry of everything, leaving not even a biscuit for that one's breakfast. Later, we all went to the creek and bathed our feet and faces in the cold water. There are as many creeks and river woods as there are veins in a leaf. Clear, crackling, they crook their way down into the little river that crawls through the woods like a green alligator. Dolly looked a sight, standing in the water with her winter suit skirt hiked up and a veil pestering her like a cloud of gnats. I asked her, "Dolly, why are you wearing that veil?" And she said, "But isn't it proper for ladies to wear veils when they go traveling?" Returning to the tree, we made a delicious jar of orangeade and talked of the future. Our assets were $47 in cash and several pieces of jewelry, notably a gold fraternity ring Catherine had found in the intestines of a hog while stuffing sausages. According to Catherine, $47 would buy us bus tickets anywhere. She knew somebody who had gone all the way to Mexico for $15. Both Dolly and I were opposed to Mexico. For one thing, we didn't know the language. Besides, Dolly said, we shouldn't venture outside the state, and wherever we went, it ought to be near a forest,
Otherwise, how would we be able to make the dropsy cure?
To tell you the truth, I think we should set up right here in Riverwoods,
she said, gazing about speculatively.
In this old tree? Said Catherine. Just put that notion out of your head, Dolly Hart.
And then,
you recall how we saw in the paper where a man bought a castle across the ocean?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.